Hello, welcome. My name is Nilesh. In this video, we are going to talk about how to prepare for DP201 exam, which is related to building or designing the Azure solution for data. Today morning, I completed this certification, and since I have already completed DP200, which is implementing an Azure data solution, once I complete DP200 and DP201, I get the certification as Azure Data Engineer Associate. So you can see here on my screen that today morning I have completed both these exams and I've been now assigned, or I've been cleared to have this certification of the Azure Data Engineer Associate. So in this video, I'm going to share my experience with the exam and how did I prepare for this exam. Let's get started by looking at what is this exam all about. So if you go to the MS Learn and the certifications part of Microsoft Learn, you will find the details about DP201 exam, about designing an Azure data solution. And you can find all the details here about what are the different skills measured. As of 31st of July, there have been some updates to this test or this certification exam. And the majority of the things this exam tries to gauge, or the skills which are gauged against, are designing an Azure data storage solution. This consists of about 40 to 45% of questions. Then designing data processing solution and the design for security and compliance. We can download this with the details of all the skills measured. And you can see here in this detailed document that earlier there used to be questions, or there was a component related to Azure SQL database. This has been removed as of 31st of July. And if you are referring to any of the study material and you find that Azure SQL database is mentioned in that, please take a note of this, that this is no longer the part of this exam. So this exam focuses on following Azure services, Azure Cosmos DB, Azure Synapse Analytics, Azure Data Lake Storage, Azure Data Factory, Azure Stream Analytics, Azure Databricks, and Azure Blob Storage. So if we leave the traditional RDBMS part, which is mainly related to the Azure SQL, all the big data related technologies are covered as part of this exam. And it also goes in depth about telling which are the specific areas, like designing non-relational cloud data stores, designing relational cloud data stores, and specifically within those areas, what are the subsections or sub areas which are covered or which are expected to be questioned during this exam. So once we have known what are the different skills which are measured, I would say it's better to go through some of these learning modules. So if you have been following my channel, you might have seen this video which I did about a couple of months ago when I cleared the DP200 exam, and I had gone on length about explaining what are the different MS Learn modules, what are the different modules available in Linux Academy and other resources which I use. So for DP201 as well, we have different modules which are available as part of the MS Learn site itself. This is the online free modules. We also have the instructor-led module where you can take up the test, or where you can prepare for the exam by taking up the instructor-led paid modules as well. Since I come from a data engineering background, and in my actual job, I do a lot of work around data engineering, I'm quite familiar with these technologies or these services which are being assessed as part of this exam. So for me, it was easier to just go through these learning modules and take up the exam. You can see that in some cases, I didn't even have to go through the specific learning module because I'm already hands-on with these tools or these services, and I didn't feel the need to go through each and every learning module here. But if you are new, what you can do, or what I tend to do initially, is just list down all the modules in an Excel file and find out what is the duration required to complete this module. So in this example, when it comes to DP201, if we take into account all the recommended paths for from the MS Learn site, there are about 23 hours of total time required to complete these seven different modules. And Let me show you one of these. So let's say if you are new to Azure Synapse, for example. Azure Synapse is the new name for SQL Data Warehouse. This was formerly called as SQL Data Warehouse. So if you want to implement a data warehouse solution with Azure Synapse Analytics, this will take about 3 hours, 2 hours, 53 minutes. And this contains multiple modules in that, or submodules. So let me see, there are three modules as part of this bigger module. And similarly, the other services will have different modules to be completed. So I recommend that you have a look at this. You gauge yourself based on your current comfort level. How much do you know about each of the service? And you can start with MS Learn in the first place. This is good. Then the next step is to find something which is more relevant to the exam, because MS Learn will give you quite a few links. It's more of a resource-based learning, where you will get links to online posts and things like that, but you don't get so much for thing which I like as I said, in the DP200 exam preparation, each person has a different style of learning, and for me, I find it easier to learn when I see something visually or when I see something in action. So for that reason, I use Linux Academy, and now Linux Academy is part of a cloud guru. So if you try to log into the Linux Academy, you will be presented with this screen where you can log in to a cloud guru using the earlier login created for Linux Academy. So I use Linux Academy, and again, going back to the DP200 video, I explained what were some of the main reasons why I prefer to go with Linux Academy. First thing is, there is one author who is authoring this course or this exam preparation, and let me search for DP201 in the search bar. I could have also gone to the recent courses, but that's fine. Let's search from the search option. And here you can see that there are two courses, or one hands-on course and one exam preparation. So this is the one which I referred from Brian Roem. This is about 16 hours or 17 hours of course. And if I go into the details of this, this is mapping to those skills which are being measured. What we saw in this document here, the different skills which are measured as part of DP201, there is sections, or there are modules within this course which maps to that. And again, here I went through the videos, and when it came to the hands-on lab, since I'm already hands-on with these technologies, I did not go through each and every hands-on lab. But if you are new, if you don't have hands-on experience with these services, I highly recommend that you try out these hands-on labs. And as I said in my earlier video as well, these hands-on lab, they come as part of the subscription to the Linux Academy, and you can do them multiple times. It's not like once you complete it, you cannot do it again. They have a time, a certain amount of time within which that hands-on lab has to be completed, maybe like 45 minutes or 90 minutes. But if you feel that you're not comfortable with those at the first attempt, you can make multiple attempts on those hands-on labs. Once you have done all these hands-on labs, and once you are comfortable after going through all these videos, there is also a practice exam or quiz. In my opinion, this practice exam is very simple. The questions here, they are meant to gauge your understanding of this particular module. But when you compare this with the actual exam is quite tricky. So I would suggest that you understand the concepts, and even if you get, let's say, 80% or 90% in this exam, the complexity of the questions which are here in this practice exam, they are, I would say, very basic or medium. Whereas the actual exam, the certification exam, the complexity is definitely higher than what we see in these questions. So I'll come to that, the structure of the exam, a little bit later. The other part which I like about Linux Academy or A Cloud Guru now is it also helps us to build a schedule. So I can go here and I can build a schedule saying what is my availability. So I can click on my available number of hours on a daily basis for the complete week. Say for example, I want to start this particular preparation for this module on let's say 11th. And when I go to the availability section, we can define what is my availability by each day of the week. So I can say for Sunday, I'm available for 3 hours. For Saturday, I'm available for 3 hours during the weekend, but during the weekdays, I'm available only for 1 hour to spend dedicatedly on this module. And based on this availability, it can come up with a schedule and I can find out when I would be able to complete the preparation for this exam. And accordingly, I can schedule or I can book the exam, the date for the exam. The other thing which I personally do is I always like to take notes, and OneNote is my preferred choice when it comes to note taking. Before I started with this particular DP201 exam preparation, I used to take notes in a regular format, but then I came across some online references where they talked about creating visual notes. And visual notes is a slightly different way of note taking, where instead of just taking textual notes, we try to put in some visual elements into our notes, which makes it quite easy for our brain to digest the information. So if you look at this particular note I'm showing, this was initially when I started the exam preparation. But as I went along and as I started incorporating the visual notes, note taking part, I found it very helpful. And I'm still new to this notes taking, visual note taking. I've been taking notes for quite a long time, but visual note taking is something quite new, and I'm pretty sure as time goes on, I will be improving on that. But let me show you some of the things that help me in terms of visual note taking. So here you can see, this is the part where I started doing note taking using visual notes. So instead of just writing plain text, these different elements that we put in the visual notes, they help to organize the information better. Say for example, when it comes to Cosmos DB, Cosmos DB offers 5 different APIs. So I'm representing those 5 different APIs and their specific features for each of the API here. And this makes it quite easy for me to capture that information in one single shot instead of writing it like all textual in one big page. So I found this really helpful. And also adding things like the colors was already part of my notes. I used to have different color combinations, but things like adding these indicators where it is like important information, that really helped to highlight things which I wanted to highlight. So all these notes, I have taken them out as PDF. And I've also taken the extract of these notes or the OneNote file itself, and I've created a GitHub repository, which I'll be sharing with all the viewers at the end of this video. The purpose of this is you can use these notes for your own reference. I believe in sharing the information, and I strongly believe that when you help somebody to get better, you also get better yourself. So I'm pretty sure you might find these notes useful if you're preparing for this exam. And that's the reason I'm going to share this as a PDF file. One of the problems I found when I export this as PDF is my formatting or the dark mode of OneNote is lost. And I do have all the text information, but if you look at the actual note, you see a difference here. So let me show you the same note which I'm seeing in OneNote. So let me just pull up one where it is having good amount of information in terms of the visual note taking. Something went wrong, and let me just open OneNote again. That's the live demo. It all works fine when we practice, but during the live recording, something or the other just shows up. So let's hope that OneNote is not behaving weird now. And if we go back into the certifications and I look at the section for DP201, yeah, so we are back here and let's look at this section. Okay, so this section is about designing security for data policies and standards. So you see that I have different visual indicators here. The notes are combination of text as well as graphic components, and there are different color combinations as well in this note. And if I take the same one in the this is the last section, so if we just go to the bottom of this PDF file, we should be able to see the same notes. Now you will see the difference that, come on, let me just refresh this page as well. And go to the end. Not sure why it's not rendering. Let me open it from the location. Okay. Let's try to zoom in a little bit. And you see here that it is showing the background of the page as white, and the text is all black and white, or the text of the color is fine. Whatever I have in my actual note, those same colors are there, but the background, because it is different, we don't get the same look and feel. And again, if I go to the end, yeah, here you can see that. So let me pull up that same note which I was showing you here. This one is regarding the design security for data policy. So we look at this section, which is starting with defense in depth, and let's go up. Yeah, so you can see here that all that formatting is lost, because when I export this as a PDF, it is not able to pick up my dark mode, and the notes, they don't look so appealing. So for this reason, what I have done is I have also exported the OneNote file itself, and I've put it in the GitHub repository. So if you go into my GitHub repository, the link of this will be available in the description. You find both the PDF files as well as OneNote file. So if you have the OneNote application, you can import these notes, and you should be able to see the same look and feel. So that's another part which I did as part of the preparation. So as I said, taking visual notes and then going through those notes to just summarize the information. So instead of writing big notes, these visual notes, they really help me to focus on key areas and to make note of key areas. And I hope that if you are referring to these notes, you will also find it useful. If you come across a solution which can export the PDF file or export OneNote file into a PDF with the background, please share it with me in the comments. I would be happy to know. I did try to look for that information, but I couldn't find anything at the moment. So let's go back and see what are the other things that I did. So note taking was one, going through the Linux Academy and going through this course. on the Linux Academy. I also took up the test. So once I went through all the videos, once I was comfortable with all the modules and the skills that are going to be measured, I did the practice test. And if I click on this, I think I did it 3 or 4 times. So again, this is to make myself comfortable and gauge my knowledge on those concepts to see how comfortable I am. So you can see here that I passed this 3 times, and I picked this up on 3 different occasions. Once I'm comfortable with this, this is when I know that now I can pick up, or I can take up the actual test. Now, I would like to share some of the things or the experience that I had with the actual DP201 test. This test consists of 42 questions, and the duration of this test is 3 hours, 180 minutes. The 42 questions that you get, they are divided into different sections. So in my case, I had 2 case studies to start with, and there were about 6 to 9 questions in these case studies. So the case study, the first one is related to a hybrid environment where we are integrating data from on-premise SQL Server, and we are using different services which are measured or which are required as part of this test, like the Azure Data Factory. There was also the SaaS integration. So there was Salesforce integration, and data had to be pulled in from Salesforce and things like that. So a typical big enterprise where you have various kinds of data coming in from different sources, you use these cloud services, how to ingest the data, how to securely store that data. And around the same use case, there were 6 questions. So the different aspects which were covered were around data storage, integration of different services, and what kind of integration runtimes would be used, as an example. The next one was around the streaming use case. So organization has streaming data coming in from multiple sources again, and what services would be required for handling the streaming data and processing that data. Once those 2 use cases are done, there is a series of questions, about 30 of them, and these are related to all these different aspects which are measured. So there is no case study here, and some of these questions are pretty straightforward. I would say about 3 or 4 questions, if you understand, because this is not related to implementing or coding, you need to understand the capabilities of the services. So if you understand the capabilities of the services, these 3 or 4 questions would be pretty straightforward, like when do you use Stream Analytics, when do you use Azure Databricks, or when do you use Azure Synapse. So those kind of very straightforward questions, if you know the capabilities of the service, you can answer them. But the other questions, some of them, they are quite tricky. I would say they are not one single use case. They're not related to one use case where you get 6 or 7 questions related to single use case, but you are given like a paragraph, and there are different requirements within that paragraph, and you need to identify what is the exact service or the solution that needs to be applied in that situation. Say for example, one of the question was around, we are using Azure Data Factory to integrate with the blob storage account or data lake storage, and we are also integrating, or we are writing the results into Azure Synapse. So what are the different kinds of authentication modes those will be required to integrate this solution end to end? So if we don't know what are the different options available, it would be quite tricky to answer these kind of questions. If you go back to my earlier video on DP200, I had also mentioned that there are various questions which are very kind of strict, in a sense that you need to know the exact options, and you also need to know what is the exact sequence for those options. In the DP200, I found only a couple of questions like this, where you need to know the multiple choice answer, where you have more than one option, and you also need to know the sequence. So I feel that if you don't practice or you don't do much hands-on. You just focus on going through all these exam modules, be it via MS Learn or from Linux Academy or any other reference. If you understand those concepts, if you can grasp that what are the capabilities of the service, you might be able to clear this exam. But I still recommend that you do hands-on so that it is much more easier, and it is easier for you to know what are the different options available. So once we have those questions, after those two case studies and 30 questions, the last part of this exam is again another case study where we have three questions related to the same case study. But the trick here is you cannot go back and change your answer. So once you answer the question and you go to the next one, you cannot go back. This is not the case for the first two case studies or the other 30 questions which are appearing in the exam. You can always go back and change your answer if you want to. But the case study part where you are answering the first and the second case study, within that case study you can go back and forth. But once you say you have completed the case study, you cannot go back and answer. Whereas the last one, it is like you have a Boolean kind of answer. There are two or three options given and you have to identify, saying is this the right solution. And if you say this is not the right solution, you answer that as the first question's answer. You go to the second one and you realize that, oh no, the first one which came was the right answer. You cannot change that. So just be mindful of this, the last case study. The types of questions which came up, I would say in terms of distribution, it is what is mentioned here. In terms of the way the questions are spread across, 40% for designing the solutions, then about 30% on data processing, and about 25 to 30% on data security and compliance. One thing which I found a bit focused, or the kind of questions which came, was about 40% of the questions were related to Cosmos DB. At one point of time, I almost felt like I was not answering the exam for the data solution, but it was so focused around Cosmos DB. But then again, it might be because of the fact that if we go back here and we look at the capabilities of Cosmos DB, it does offer quite a lot in terms of the capabilities. And when we look at the different capabilities, I'm sorry why this display is not refreshed. Okay, yeah. So in terms of like the consistency level, it has got five different consistencies. In terms of the APIs, it has got five different APIs. Then when we look at data retention, high availability, disaster recovery, so in all these kind of different sections, the questions were related to Cosmos DB. So I would say out of all the questions, about 40% were, in my case, the exam question that I got, were related to Cosmos DB. So if you are preparing, I would ask you to focus on Cosmos DB and understand all the different options related to Cosmos DB in each area, right from data security, data retention, different APIs that Cosmos DB provides, and things around that. Then there were some questions around the Synapse as well, Azure Synapse, because Azure Synapse also has different options. It can support batch workloads, it can support streaming workloads. So in that regards, there were different options or different questions which came around the Azure Synapse. And the data storage, data lake storage, the retention period for data lake storage also had different questions related to data lake storage as well. So I would say focus more on the Cosmos DB as first part, and then the others, a broad knowledge is required. So in terms of all the questions, it's like there are some questions where you involve more than one services, and in that way you might be engaged on not just one service but multiple services within the same question. Uh, Then the next part I would say is in terms of the connectivity. So there were some questions which were focused around, because this is talking about, this test is about the approaches and the concept. It's not so much about implementing, but designing. So we need to know what are the different options available from a design point of view. So many of the questions, they had this service connectivities and integrations in place. So for example, in case of streaming, the different options available when we start streaming the data and what are the different services which can be used. So we need to know in which case we need to use a particular service, because streaming, say I take streaming as an example, we can stream data, or we can do stream processing using Databricks. We can do stream processing also using Azure Synapse. So depending on the exact use case, we should be able to identify what is more suited in that question. So the approach and the reasons why a particular service is more fitted or more suited in that scenario is what is required. So there is no straightforward question, unlike the practice questions which we get in the LinuxX Academy practice questions. I would say that most of the questions in the actual DP201 exams are tricky question, and if you don't get the actual question what they are trying to gauge, you might give a wrong answer. So some of these questions, they are quite lengthy. I would say like you will have a paragraph, and that paragraph might be added there just to mislead you. For an example, the actual question might be pretty straightforward, but there are many things which are put in that paragraph just to confuse you. And if you don't really understand what is the exact question that they are trying to ask, I'm pretty sure that you might get confused and give a wrong answer. So just be careful and just understand what is the actual need or what is the actual problem statement, and give your answer accordingly. So with that, I think I have covered all. So whatever I wanted to share with you guys, so starting with what are the different skills which are measured in terms of this exam. So we looked at, I think it's here. Let's go back. All the different skills which are measured. Then we looked at the MS Learn, what are the free modules available in MS Learn, and if you have to go through all those, it could take about 23 hours for you to finish. Then I also showed you quickly my reference point for designing or using Linux Academy, my preferred e-learning platform, mainly because of three reasons. One is it gives us a schedule. I can build a schedule for my own exam preparation, then I can do the hands-on labs, and I can take the practice exam. So those are the three distinguishing factors because of which I preferred Linux Academy. But if you don't have Linux Academy subscription, and let's say you are more of other providers, you like something like Pluralsight, for example. Pluralsight also offers, as an alternative to Linux Academy, I'm saying, learning path for the Azure Data Solution DP201. But as I said in my previous video also, these videos are done by multiple authors, and that's where I find it difficult at times, because the information is repeated in some cases, and also the level of information is, it could be different. Like in this case, we have one course done by a guy called Gary Krudzinkas on selecting the appropriate data service, storage service, and there are other courses which are done by John Saville. I particularly like John Saville. He is a great teacher. He has a YouTube channel as well, which is very, very informative and quite updated, regularly updated. I highly recommend that you subscribe to John Saville's YouTube channel. But in this case, he has done three videos which are part of the DP201, or three courses which are part of DP201 learning course for Pluralsight. This is still better, but in case of DP200, I found that there were multiple authors, and sometimes the information, the granularity, as well as there was a lot of repetition in terms of these courses. So that is the reason I prefer Linux Academy, which is done by one author, and I can follow that author quite consistently. If you are referring to something like Udemy again, Udemy is another quite popular e-learning platform. If I just do DP201 designing an Azure Data Solution search with this keywords or this text, there are so many courses which come out. And again, you can go by the rating of the course, or if you know the author, you can go by that. Again, I'm not very particular about which learning platform you use, but my personal recommendation is don't stick to just one resource. Like, don't just stick to MS Learn, or just don't stick to the e-learning platform of your choice. Try to mix and match, because the information that is required might be scattered across these resources, and you might find things which are not covered as part of, let's say, MS Learn. They get covered as part of the e-learning platform course, or things which are not covered in the e-learning platform course by the author, you might find it in the MS Learn or other online resources. So I highly recommend that don't stick to just one source of information. Diversify your source of information. And in terms of sharing the notes, I will share this repository, and you will have the PDF as well as the OneNote file there. I hope that you find this notes useful. And if you find something which is missing, and if you want to recommend something, please feel free, put it in the comments, and I'll be very happy to incorporate that in some of the future notes that I take. I always like to keep improving, so any suggestions are always welcome. So with that, I hope you have all the resources and you found this useful to get started with DP201 and be a data engineer using Azure services. And these resources that I shared, hopefully they will help you get started, or if you have already started, do something better. Thank you for watching this video. If you find this useful, please hit the like button, subscribe, and share it with your friends. Thanks once again for watching this.